Good morning, and thank you for having me. I'm really honored to be here. I'd like to say I'm very pleased that I got asked to talk about the classic presentation instead of the common presentation, because I think all too often we do hear stories that are much like Dr. Blazek's, where the presentations aren't really all that classic. So there are patients with these symptoms, but often a lot more as well. Not really too much disclose here. I'm on the medical advisory board for the foundation. We're building the registry. I'm super involved in that. Thank you to everybody else who is as well. And I am not the artist on any of these. So I'm sure you're all aware there are some criteria for diagnosis of SIH or spontaneous intracranial hypotension. And Dr. Shavink has been very kind to us and given us a very simple way to approach it. Criterion A is that there's a leak, and I like that. And then criteria B is if you don't see a leak, then you find one of these other features. And criterion C is that you have some of those features and an orthostatic headache. So he's given us the most common symptom, and I'm sure we're all aware of that. Then even before Dr. Shavink's criteria, we had the ICHD-3. And again, this is a headache diagnosis. So you can have a leak without a headache, but obviously most commonly it's a headache, or at least there is a headache. And so this was the first criteria. I think very, very frequently we do see an abrupt onset. One day I was ticking along, I was fine, and then I wasn't. There's something going on. And as we said, most commonly there's an orthostatic feature. That means it's related to being upright. And even Miriam was able to tell us, Merriam-Webster. So 70 to 100% of people, depending on which studies you look at, will have orthostatic or just plain not orthostatic headache. It's often diffuse, but people will often describe this back of the head type pressure. 90% of those headaches are currently reported as orthostatic. And we definitely see that, but we also know in the literature, you look what you find what you look for. So that may evolve over time and we may see less of that. We don't know yet. Often relieved by lying down, and we've got reference in the our last talk to that 48-hour flat test really improving the symptoms. Sometimes we don't see that being upright makes it worse so much as a second half of the day headache. The headache always comes on and worsens, and the worst time is before I lay back down at night. We often have a description of a coat hanger pain. So there's a lot of neck stiffness reported, and sometimes that intrascapular pain. But keeping in mind that is often also a description of pain in autonomic symptoms. So this can be hard to differentiate, but we do often see neck stiffness in CSF leak. Auditory symptoms, that sensation of fullness or ringing. This can be orthostatic or not. Sensitivity to sound or hyperacusis, or like sounding like you're in a tunnel or a change in the sounds. Nausea is a very, very frequent symptom, reported in 20 to 60%. I would suggest I see it probably slightly more than that in my patients. Dizziness frequently reported, not just vertigo, that's probably less frequent than this lightheaded disequilibrium, that trampolines type walking on a in a bouncy castle or feeling off balance. Sensitivity to light is a frequent reported symptom or other visual symptoms, less commonly diplopia, but we do see blurry vision and diplopia. But photophobia is a very, very frequently reported symptom. And this one is not reported so much in the literature, that brain fog and neurofatigue. You don't see it in the classic literature, but you do see it when you recently, there was a paper where they had the patients report what their symptoms were rather than a checklist of here's what I think you should have and tick the boxes. And it was a much, much higher reported symptom was that brain fog and neurofatigue. It was not usually even called neurofatigue. When we ask these questions, people call it fatigue, but it is that if I read or I do something like that makes me feel exhausted. And that is something I see in my patients all the time. And I think is a very common symptom that we just haven't been asking about classically. So these are the symptoms that we think about as the most common symptoms and sort of the symptoms that are frequently seen in spinal CSF leak. And there's lots of papers that are talking about that, but I think we are going to get better and better at this as time goes on.